which is quite an achievement. There's another data point that you might like to pay attention to. More Indians own a mobile phone than the number of Indians who brush their teeth with a toothbrush. It's a very mind-boggling number. There are about 700 million toothbrushes which are sold in India every year. Assuming that a toothbrush lasts for about a month or 2 months, about 100, 150 million Indians buy a toothbrush regularly. There are 900 million Indians who have cell phones. So in many ways, a poor person, a rich person, whoever you might like to use as your demographic sample, finds it more valuable to have a phone than to buy a toothbrush to brush. You might brush your teeth with your fingers, you might brush it with a twig, you might not brush at all. The choice is yours, but the relative importance is what I'm talking about. So mobility clearly puts enormous computing and communication power in our hands and across the human race, across all countries. The second force is social media. Now, human beings are a very social race. We like to communicate with each other in groups like this, individually, in families, and all kinds of aggregations. What has happened in the last about 8 or 9 years is the reach and the extent and the richness of that communication has gone up by several orders of magnitude. And it is enabled by mobility, it's enabled by some of the other forces, but this is enabling human beings across the planet to find each other, to share interests, to collaborate, to communicate, to just be in hopefully productive ways, valuable to each other. 50 years ago, this was not even conceived of. 30 years ago, this was possible with the early days of the internet and the personal computer, but it was nowhere near what it is in terms of scale and reach. Even 10 years ago, this was feasible and certainly getting to be pervasive, but it was still in the few millions of people who used this method to talk to each other. Again, show of hands, how many of you are on at least one social media platform, Facebook, Twitter, Google, whatever? So there you go. So this is an example of, this is natural. I mean, if you don't have a presence or you're not connected with one of these platforms, you're missing something. So you will get into those platforms. The third force is cloud computing. Many of the things that we are getting used to, whether it's email, all of you have email accounts on something, Google, Hotmail, Yahoo, etc., etc. No? Okay. All of that happens somewhere. Do you really care where your mailbox is or whose machine it's running on or where is the technology which is underpinning? You don't. A lot of the cloud computing platforms support social media. A lot of them support your mobile applications. A lot of them support your marketplaces, your online shopping and so on. So all of these are now offering unprecedented capability in terms of scale of computing required to support many of the other things. The bottom two are relatively more recent. If I take data and analytics first, data is the underpinning of computer science. In fact, computing used to be called information technology. In fact, it is still called IT in many acronym ways, but we really forget the value of I in that IT. It is information that computers were seen to be the first and best applied to in terms of processing of information. Today, that processing of information has reached another level with our ability to process enormous scale of data. And this has now reached levels where the power of analytics, as it is called, is getting into more and more pervasive ways. So you run analytics when you go to an online shopping site and you start seeing when you're browsing a particular product, maybe it's a new cell phone or maybe it's some other product, you start seeing prompts on the right-hand side coming from the shopping site saying, you know what, you're looking at these models, but maybe you should look at these models as well because they're kind of similar to what you're doing. Or people like you who are buying these products, your friends or your other colleagues or demographics are buying these kind of products. So this is the kind of power of analytics which is coming in all kinds of spaces. And I'll give you more examples in the next slide. In fact, if you look at the... No, just go back to the slide, please. Yeah. If you look at the fifth force, artificial intelligence and robotics, you know, this is the one which is taken the longest to be understood in terms of potential. The founder, if you will, of the science of artificial intelligence in many ways was Alan Turing. Imitation Game, heard about it, seen the movie? Those of you who have not seen the movie, please go see it. I mean, just as a computer science lesson, convince your parents, your teachers that this is pure computer science. It's not a movie, it's a technical lesson. Turing, amongst many other accomplishments, wrote the first principles of what is AI. He wrote a very seminal paper in the 1940s, which is still today called the Turing Test for artificial intelligence. But today we are close to actually implementing many of those things. And the science and art of robotics is now developing so that we can have intelligence both in mechatronic robots as well as in software robots, which it implements. So these are the digital five forces. So think of them as the five fingers on your hand. Mobility, social media, data and analytics, artificial intelligence, and then cloud is the thumb which powers many of the other four. Like the five fingers on your hand, each of these is very powerful in itself. But the really interesting things happen at the intersections. You can combine these two fingers and you can write. You can combine these fingers and you can type or play music. You combine all five fingers, you can hit somebody on their head. Right? So the combination of these digital five forces is what is really giving us the opportunity. So on the next slide now, you'll see that all the fun is in intersections of the digital five forces amongst themselves as a sort of a computer science oriented view of the world. But this chart is showing you the fun at the intersections of computer science and other engineering disciplines. The power of these digital technologies is now invading many, many branches of engineering. So first of all, if you are a mechanical engineer and you're looking at how is it that I can now leverage these digital technologies, I'll give you one example, or maybe both the examples. ICME is an acronym which is becoming very prevalent in the mechanical, chemical, and materials engineering spaces. ICME stands for Integrated Computational Materials Engineering. This is the way by which people are using techniques of data, analytics, artificial intelligence, to some extent social media, and of course cloud computing, to try and optimize the way in which a material is conceptualized at the atomic level, at the metallurgical level, at the chemical level, which is multiphysics modeling, chemical modeling, and so on, all the way to the creation of the first samples. Then you're taking the samples through an engineering process to make them manufacturable. Then you're taking them through a qualification process against the product that you want to say that I want a certain tensile strength, I want a certain weight, I want a certain hardness, I want physical attributes of various kinds. Then you actually have to produce it in scale, which is your supply chain design and your aggregation technologies. And then finally, you have to deploy it in the field, test it, and make sure that it is performing as designed. If you take this life cycle in a materials intensive or mechanical intensive industry like aeronautics, a typical material for, let's say, an aircraft takes about 20 years from the time it is conceptualized in the lab, let's say as a composite or a metallic aggregate of some sort, to the time that the aircraft starts flying with that material. It takes 20 years for that life cycle without these computational interventions that I'll talk about. Now with ICME and computer scientists now collaborating with material scientists, mechanical engineers, manufacturing people, industrial engineers, aeronautic designers, computer scientists are now saying that I can help you improve the cycle time, as it is called, of that process from 20 years down to maybe 5. Now, this is a big deal for aeronautic engineers. Similarly, for automotive engineers. Similarly, for people making consumer goods or health implants. So the mechanical and chemical world is no longer siloed. The intersection with computer science is dramatically changing the way in which you do mechanical engineering, material science, chemical engineering, physics, and so on. Because now the tools of analytics, the tools of data, the tools of artificial intelligence, the tools of cloud computing are available to you. And so you can't say, I'm a mechanical engineer, I will not do or I will not learn these techniques. If you learn them, you can be a super duper mechanical engineer, you can be a super duper aeronautic engineer, and so on. So that's one example. If I go to the civil engineering side, civil engineers are now looking at extraordinary power that these can bring, these technologies, the digital five forces can bring to their world. Now, people at various branches of civil engineering, I'll just take two. One is transportation, right? Constructing of highways, roads, and cities, and layouts of urban planning and town planning, and so on. That area of civil engineering is getting extraordinary lift from two of the forces, mobility and social media. How many of you use Google Maps to find your way around? Have you noticed something in Google Maps in the last about a year? Some red marks start appearing on it. You figured out what that is? Those are traffic patterns. It tells you if you want to go from here to, let's say, Madhya Kailash Junction, what is the expected time that you will spend on the road if you're driving or you're in public transport. And they use something very, very simple at a certain level to estimate that time. Can you guess what that is? How do they know that there is traffic on old Mahabalipuram Road from Hindustan University to Madhya Kailash? How do they figure it out? They use mobile phone densities by buying data from cell phone operators. So if they find a large number of mobile phones are clustered, let us say, at Sholinganallur Junction, they assume that it's because a lot of people in their buses, cars, whatever, on the road, are all stuck there because they're not moving for a period of time. So they red mark that area and say, oh, okay, this cluster is static, it's not moving, it's going to take 10 minutes to cross the junction. So this is mobility, data and analytics, overlaid on some sort of an artificial intelligence routine, which basically says it's going to take you 45 minutes to go. If everything is green, actually blue on Google Maps, you have a clear path ahead to travel. Now, for a civil engineer who's doing traffic simulation, traffic planning, layout of roads, layout of localities to say, should I put a mall here or should I put a residential district here or should I put industrial area here, for town planners, for road managers, for traffic managers, for anybody in that thing, this large-scale simulation is invaluable because now you're doing large-scale simulation with real data. You can do it dynamically by just looking at these kinds of capabilities. Similarly, if you're designing a building like this for academic purposes, maybe an office building, maybe an industrial building, maybe a shopping mall, a residential multi-storied tower, and so on, the amount of analytics that you can do on the people who live there, their behavior, how they'll move from point to point, what do they do in the mornings, what do they do in the afternoons, the evenings, traffic patterns, walking patterns, it is phenomenal in what you can do by putting sensors into buildings.